all the samples and the standards. And then we prepare the standard curves as a normalized area of the analyte in the standard to the area of the internal standard. This way we can overcome some of the matrix effects, but not all. But you can see to a large extent, it can be handled. This is showing the recovery variation after spiking a known concentration of pharmaceutical in wastewater and then trying to recover after solid phase extraction with the ISDM method. We see that still in the literature, there's a wide variety of these ranges are showing the range for any particular compound reported in the literature. You see that we can have recovery varying from as low as 40% to about 80% for acetaminophen. This is literature reported values for various pharmaceuticals. These are some of our values when we found, we were using wastewater from two different treatment plants in Mumbai. And we find that with the ISDM, we still have higher values, but there is still a lot of variability. In nanopure water, when I measure with ISDM versus no ISDM, that is, I don't use isotope label standards, I see no variation in recovery at all. All is pretty good. But when I have wastewater or when I have prepared artificial water where I have spiked organic matter, such as this, you see that WISDM, that is without the internal standard added, you see very low recoveries. Whereas after doing the ISDM method by adding label standards, you get significantly better recoveries. The other thing that can happen is as your concentration factor changes for the wastewater analysis, because you know in influent versus effluent, we may often go with differences in concentration factor when we are analyzing because our expected concentration there is different, right? Sometimes when we do that, we may even see variation due to the concentration factor effect. That also can be lower when we use the ISDM method for analysis. These are some control studies done by adding pharmaceuticals to wastewater together with adding dissolved organic carbon, tenfold, 10 milligram per liter dissolved organic carbon added to 1.1 milligram per liter of each pharmaceutical, and that there is a mix of pharmaceuticals. So you see that the presence of DOM impacts the analysis, but the impact can be lowered when we use the ISDM method. These are some of the actual variation in two treatment plants, and we did 24-hour composite samples over 2 years, and this is showing the variation. And when you see the variation, it's close to the range is sort of close to what is reported in the literature, but it also exceeds the range reported in the literature for a few of the compounds that are highlighted, like azithromycin, etc. What is reported in the literature versus what we got is somewhat higher. Regarding the removal of pharmaceuticals that we found in the two treatment plants. So this is showing the minimum and the maximum values of removal we found in the various sets of analysis done. Apparently, it seems that we are getting sometimes quite high removal, although sometimes the removal is very less. And in some cases, instead of removal, it looks like there is negative removal, which is basically increase in concentration between the in the effluent compared to the influent. So what is happening here really? So there are various mechanisms that may be at play. So apart from volatilization and biotransformation and photolysis, we may be having significant removal by adsorption onto sludge. And this is likely to depend on the octanol water partition coefficient of the compounds. And for some compounds like carbamazepine, as I said, you see increase in concentration in the effluent. This may be due to deconjugation of the hydroxylated and conjugated metabolites that are present in wastewater during the treatment. So this is a very strange effect that is seen definitely for carbamazepine, widely reported in the literature, which we also found significantly. So even after removal from the wastewater, the concentration that is remaining in the water may pose a risk in terms of health effects. So these are some of the photolysis studies. We found that in lagoons, one of the treatment plant here was a lagoon. So in lagoons, there is a lot of possibility for photolysis of pharmaceuticals also. So we did some control studies to explore the photolysis and found that photolysis can be affected not only by direct photolysis, but also through indirect photosynthesized degradation of compounds like acetaminophen as shown here. And often it may not be a complete transformation, but only partial transformation. So what you see is that in presence of dissolved organic matter, we have increased degradation, which is manifested through a reduction in the half-life. And whereas in presence of particulate organic matter, we found significant hindrance to the degradation of acetaminophen. However, these effects depend upon the type of pharmaceutical. We had done these studies for a range of pharmaceuticals. I've shown only one. Now coming to degradation of pharmaceuticals through tertiary processes. Here I will highlight a study we did with TiO2 ZNO nanocomposite. So this was a photolysis process in a controlled study where we were looking at both individual pharmaceuticals and mixtures of pharmaceuticals with this novel nanocomposite, which was also active under visible light. Okay. So I'm showing just the degradation of one compound, acetaminophen, by photocatalysis. So here we had 10 milligram per liter of the acetaminophen together with 10 milligram per liter only of the nanocomposite. This is much lower than what is typically used in the literature. And we used UVC irradiation or visible irradiation. Under both cases, we find effective degradation. In fact, this NH group here is released. So we see increase in ammonium. And then subsequently, we see the ammonium getting converted to nitrate. Ammonium is decreasing, nitrate is increasing. And that effect is seen both under UV irradiation and visible irradiation. And here I'm showing that acetaminophen is decreasing. At the same time, various products are formed from acetaminophen. We could talk about the pathway, et cetera. I'm not going into that. So various products are formed and degraded, and eventually it is present in the form of acetic acid and acetamide. So this is degradation of acetaminophen. We could show degradation for a range of pharmaceuticals using this system, but this is through photocatalysis. However, many of the pharmaceuticals were also sensitive to photolysis. So we found decrease due to in the concentration of the pharmaceutical. However, what we found is the transformation was very minor. And as a result, there was no change in the toxicity. We were following the endocrine disruption activity, and we found that for estradiol and ethinyl estradiol, this is a natural hormone and a synthetic hormone, we found that there is significant removal of endocrine disrupting activity with photocatalysis. And so degradation in DI water was showed a profile, but we found that there was alteration when we changed to lake water versus wastewater. So the degradation is significantly a function of other things in the matrix. And the other issue is which toxicity to select when we are trying to detect. So maybe the products formed may manifest some other types of toxicity also. So this is one thought that we may need to dwell upon. I'm just touching briefly on a work done by Pooja Nag, another student who just finished her PhD. This is a work in collaboration with Professor Shomo Mukherjee. Here a sensor was developed. This is an optic fiber sensor, U-vent optic fiber sensor with gold nanoparticles, where we used a Pseudomonas aeruginosa strain as a biosensor for analyzing third generation beta-lactam antibiotics. So cefadexime is shown here. And it is shown that we can do the analysis even quantitatively by looking at absorbance change. So the measurement that is done here is the absorbance change at this time, which is around 140 minutes versus 20 minutes, difference in absorbance at that point. And we can see that it is a concentration dependent response that we can get. So we can, this is showing that we can use also biosensors can be used for analysis of pharmaceuticals like antibiotics. And there is a scope for doing a lot of work in this area to lower the cost of analysis. Because if we go by the traditional route, the cost is prohibitively high per sample. So to summarize, SPE followed by LC-MS/MS analysis, which is the gold standard for determination of pharmaceuticals, needs quite a bit of optimization. And when analyzing the pharmaceuticals through this method, we need to preferably use methods such as ISDM so that we can get quantitative values. And I'd like to highlight that the removal in WWTPs can happen due to a wide variety of mechanism, and it may not be a complete removal that is happening when we are following just the parent compound. It may simply be that the compound is getting biotransformed or accumulating in another phase, like the sludge associating with sludge. So also photocatalysis, a lot of studies are done. Most studies are done in DI water, where effect of co-contaminants are not clearly understood. So it is important to understand the performance of photocatalytic processes in presence of the matrix. So significant differences may occur in the degradation through photocatalytic processes also in the presence of matrix. And the fact is toxicity studies should also be accompanied with any degradation studies, because often you have parent compound disappearing, but intermediates accumulating in the system. And this can be monitored to ensure that toxic effects are removed. However, sometimes one type of toxicity may be reduced, but the products formed may lead to other type of toxicities. So for this type of thing, we may have to use a battery of toxicity tests to get a better understanding. And to highlight, the challenge is the low concentration and the complex mix of pharmaceuticals that exist in the wastewater matrix. That is what makes it a challenge to analyze this system. With that, I'd like to acknowledge the students and collaborators who have worked with me, Dr. Sanjeev Mohapatra, Dr. Gayatri Menon, and Dr. Pooja Nag, all of whom have finished their PhD now. And my collaborators, Professor Lokesh Padhe in New Zealand, Auckland, and Professor Shankara Tatipathi, he's in the Energy Science and Engineering Department, Professor Shomo Mukherjee in Bioscience and Bioengineering. And I'd like to acknowledge DST funding from the Water Technology Initiative. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. So if there is some quick questions, so we can go with that. Otherwise, like you, yeah.
Should I stop the share?
Yeah, you can stop, Professor Mukherjee. So there is one question. How much percentage of water approximately can we purify using the above method? Can we use RO to remove the pharmaceuticals waste as the purification provided by RO plant are much higher? So,
Removal by RO for pharmaceuticals. I think that yes, we should be able to remove to some extent. My concern is that RO is not very effective for species that are uncharged. As you know, for ions, it is very effective, but for uncharged species, it may not be very effective. So, but some of the pharmaceuticals are also polar, so possibly some removal may happen. I haven't specifically looked at this aspect, removal through RO, but I'm sure to some extent it would be removed additionally, but I can't really comment on what is the degree of removal.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. Any other questions from panelists? and the attendees can use the question and answer panel. There is yes, so yes, so there is one question, and by this we will move to another talk, and all the other question we will discuss during the panel discussion. So this question is, can we use HRLC MSMS method analysis for groundwater?
Yes, absolutely. See, the concern here is in groundwater, concentrations may be lower than in wastewater. So the degree of concentration that you have to do is accordingly has to be increased. We did a 1,000-fold concentration for wastewater. You may have to concentrate more when you are using groundwater. But we have done studies in quantifying for lake water also, like we analyzed Pawai lake water, where we could quantify even with a 1,000-fold concentration. So groundwater should definitely be possible.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. And other question we'll take during the panel discussion. So now I would like to invite Professor Alok Sinha from IIT ISM Dhanbad for the talk. So meanwhile, Professor Sinha can share his slide and I will give his brief introduction. So Professor Sinha has done his BE and ME from EMU in civil engineering and then the hydraulic structures. And after that, he has done his PhD in environmental engineering in a civil engineering department from IIT Kanpur, where he has worked on degradation of different chlorinated compounds. So he has many awards during his life, and he has his main research area at present is groundwater remediation, biodegradation, and emerging contaminant degradation using different processes such as advanced oxidation processes. So with this, I would like to invite Professor Sinha, where he is going to talk about anti-cancer drug degradation using electrochemical oxidation. So welcome, Professor Sinha. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Professor Singh. Are you able to hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you, Professor Sinha. Please.
Thank you very much. And good morning to all of you present. So today I am going to give a talk on the assessment of graphite electrode on the removal of anti-cancer drug cytrabine by electrochemical oxidation process. So this work has been done by one of my PhD students, Charulata Shivodia. So she is still pursuing her PhD, and she has taken here we have done the comparison of two type of electrodes, that is anodes, basically the graphite anode and copper anode, on the degradation of cytrabine, basically, which is anti-cancer drug. So these slides will be having the introduction, the overview, the electrochemical degradation of cytrabine, and the conclusions that will be there, be followed. So mainly the anthropogenic, we can say these emerging contaminants can be anthropogenics, or they can be naturally organic occurring chemicals, or they can be microorganisms which are present and which are not monitored in the environment, and that's why they are unregulated. So that is the main problem of this thing, these emerging contaminants, that as Professor Mukherjee also told, that their quantification in the environment is very, very tedious process, right? So that's why they remain unregulated in the environment, and that's why they can come to us and they can harm because of their highly persistent nature, and they can be highly harmful, and they can be ecotoxicological in nature. So a lot of we can say pharmaceuticals, personal care products, and household products, they can be treated as the emerging contaminants where they are undetected and unregulated. And because here we can talk about the pharmaceutical active compounds, which are which have boosted a lot of interest in the scientific community. So because they are highly, we can say, toxic, they can be genotoxic, they can be mutagenic, and they can cause a lot of problems if they come back to us in different forms. So as you're talking about the pharmaceuticals, and Professor Mukherjee also told about the pharmaceuticals, so we can have different type of pharmaceuticals like antibiotics, we can have analgesics, and we can have the psychiatric drugs. So they can be pharmaceutical active compounds, and they can be found in different stages. For example, they can go into the environment during the R&D and manufacturing stage, they can go during the distribution stage, they can go into the environment during the consumption stage, and they can also be, we can say that when we are disposing it off, then also they can again go back into the environment. And the concern is that the metabolites and transformation products can also be there, which can be more dangerous, which can be more, we can say, toxic than the parent compounds. And they are basically, when we are consuming these, and they can again come back to the environment. And similarly, when we are disposing them off inappropriate management of these compounds, so then also it can create a lot of problems. So as the fate of these pharmaceutical compounds, we can see that during the manufacture, during the their administration in the hospitals or during the household's usage, it can come to the wastewater treatment plants, it can go to the landfill sites. From there, they can basically again go into the aquatic environment, and then they can enter the the food chain, and they can basically accumulate there, and they can come back to us in different forms. So cytostatic drugs, which are used for anti-cancer treatment, so they are, because their consumption is increasing, right? Because of the increase in the consumption, their key emission source is the hospital effluents, from where they can go into the surface water, they can go into the groundwater, they can go into the drink, and they can come into the drinking water, and then they can have toxic effects on the natural environment, and they can cause a lot of harmful influence on the people who are non-patients. So we can see here that there is some literature that we have collected, and we can see that a lot of these cytostatic drugs, they are found in the wastewater, and their detection in the wastewater is in nanograms per liter. Similarly, the cytobine drug has also been found, and it is basically found around 14 nanograms per liter in the wastewater. So that's why we've taken this cytobine as a target drug.
Professor Sinha, sorry to interrupt you. There is something coming in right-hand side of your screen, and that's why sometimes we are not able to see the whole slide. Can you try to remove this? There is two things, and one in bottom, yeah, and one in right side. Yes.
Okay. So it's okay now. Is it okay?
It's better. Please proceed. Yeah. Thank you, Professor.
Okay. So here, these drugs are basically used for the chemotherapy treatment, and they can be used for anti-tumor and antiviral activities. And these drugs are basically, they fall in the category of anti-metabolites. That is, they interfere with the DNA synthesis of the cell. And the cytobine is basically a structure analog of pyrimidine and purine base. So you can see this is the structure of the cytobine, and this drug is quite persistent in nature, and it is not biodegradable. So we can use advanced oxidation processes for treatment of this drug, where basically we see that when we are having the wastewater treatment plant, the conventional processes, they cannot treat this type of drug, and as basically it is biologically toxic and they are non-biodegradable in nature. So that's why we can use certain electrochemical oxidation processes so that we can treat these drugs in the wastewater. So the electrochemical advanced oxidation process can have two pathways. We can have the direct oxidation, direct anodic oxidation can happen, where dot OH radical can oxidize the drugs. Or we can have the indirect generation of oxidants, like we can have the persulfate generation, we can have the fluorine species, or we can have perphosphate generation, which can reduce the, which can degrade the these drugs. So the pollutant removal mechanism in electrooxidation can be the direct oxidation, where the, we can say, the physis of dot OH radicals, the reactive oxygen species, they can degrade the drugs. Or there can be indirect oxidation method, where the chloride ions which are present in the electrolyte, it can get converted to chlorine, and also in the form of the hypochlorous acid or hypochlorite ions, and then it can degrade the drugs. So the oxidation, this is the oxidation method. It's just a graphical, we can say, representation, where we can see that the dot OH radical can be stopped on the anode, and where the direct oxidation can take place, where the chloride ions can get converted to chlorine and HOCl, and then it can degrade the organic compounds, that is the pharmaceuticals. And here we have taken the graphite electrode, because graphite electrode is having a good potential, oxygen potential, evolution potential, and the silicate is also cheap. So we have taken this graphite electrode so that we can use it for the degradation of this drug for anodic oxidation. So a lot of literature was searched, and it was found that other electrodes, for example, platinum, iridium, the boron doped diamond, titanium, rubidium oxide, so they all are equally used for the degradation of this drug. But the graphite has not been tried yet, so that's why we used graphite, so that we can degrade this drug by using graphite electrode. Similarly, the cytarabine drug was basically, it was found that UV radiation has been tried, gamma radiation has been tried, photocatalysis, titanium dioxide, and the photodegradation has been tried. But the main problem is that the reaction time was quite high, which we thought that we can reduce the reaction time in this electrochemical oxidation process. So a very simple system was used, where we used two electrodes which were there, which was of graphite, and this is the power system that's there, and aeration was done so that we can have the reactive oxygen species generation take place inside the reactor. And the 750 milliliter of the working volume was there in the reactor, 20 milligram per liter of cytarabine was taken. A higher concentration of cytarabine was taken so that we can study that what is the fate of the cytarabine during the oxidation of this cytarabine, right? And this electrode area, the 3 voltage electrode voltage was taken, 3 volts, and the distance between the electrode was 2 centimeters. The electrolyte concentration was NaCl, it was 0.05 molar. And the quantification of the cytarabine was done by using HPLC. So we saw that at low pH, the degradation of the cytarabine was higher. And similarly, as the voltage, the current density was increased, the removal efficiency also increased. So we thought that we can take 3 pH as pH 3 as the optimum pH, as well as 10 milliampere per square centimeter as the current density for degradation of the cytarabine. And as the concentration of cytarabine was increased, it was found that the removal efficiency decreased because of the concentration was higher. So it's possible that because of the less oxidation of the cytarabine, the removal efficiency decreased in the electrolyte. So key findings here was that around 0.05 molar NaCl was taken as electrolyte, and at acidic pH and cytarabine concentration of 20 ppm and current density of 10 milliampere per square centimeter, the removal efficiency of cytarabine was around 98%. And here we also found out that the chlorine species, that is the indirect oxidation method, was the main method for the removal of the cytarabine. So it was also compared with a metal electrode where we used copper as anode. So we found that the degradation efficiency was not as high as we found in the graphite electrode. And similarly here, as the current efficiency was increased, the degradation efficiency increased initially, but lately it basically decreased. It may be because of the formation of the copper hydroxide sludge and deposition on the anode that basically hampered the degradation efficiency. And here also the effect of the initial concentration of the cytarabine was increased, we found that the degradation efficiency decreased in the similar way. That is, here we found that dot OH radicals were mainly responsible for the degradation of the cytarabine, but because we are having this such deposition, as well as there is a, basically we can say the other side reactions were there. For example, the oxidation of the electrode generated H2O2, it resulted in the decreased efficiency of the cytarabine degradation. So we can see here that the dot OH radicals are found out in the water, and we found that during the copper electrode, the dot OH radical increased. But in case of the graphite electrode, the dot is always radical increased to a certain extent, but then it basically was constant. So the higher generation of dot age radical took place in the copper electrode, but because of the side reactions which are happening, so the degradation efficiency was not as high. But in case of the graphite electrode, the efficiency was higher, and it is because of the chlorine, byproducts that were formed. So they resulted in the degradation of the cytokine. So to confirm this theory, we also used tertiary butyl alcohol, which can scavenge the dot-OH radical. So we also found that as the TBA was added during the copper electrode oxidation, we found that the removal efficiency decreased manifold. Right? So this means that the dot-OH radicals were responsible for the degradation of cytokine in the copper electrode. But in case of the graphite electrode, when we found that the degradation efficiency of cytokine was not hampered. So this means that the dot-OH radicals were not responsible for the degradation of the cytokine. The chlorine species which are generated, that is HOCl and Cl2, so they were responsible for the degradation of the cytokine. So here, as the NaCl concentration basically was increased, we found that the electrolyte concentration was increased, the degradation rate was also enhanced, and the energy consumption also reduced in this case. And the stability of graphite electrode was also studied. So after 40 cycles, we found that the percentage of the carbon, it reduced from 92 to 88%. So this means that the graphite electrode was quite robust, and it can basically, it will not corrode, and it can sustain the electrochemical process for a long time. So then we went for the identification of the byproducts. So in case of the graphite electrode, the peak which was there for the cytokine, it shifted quite a bit, right? It was nearly 271 at initially, but it shifted to around 230 or 240. This means that there are certain byproducts that were forming in the graphite electrode, whereas in the copper electrode, the peak did not shift much. So this means that here the degradation products and degradation was also low. So basically, we then went for the identification of the products in the graphite electrode. The TOC analysis was also done. So we found that in the graphite electrode, the TOC removal was around 60%. So this means that the mineralization of the cytokine was around 60% in case of the graphite electrode. Later, we did the pathways for the cytokine degradation, and we found that the cytosine was the main the byproduct that was forming. But we also found that there are certain chlorinated byproducts that are formed. So this may increase the toxicity of the byproducts that are formed during the degradation of cytokine by using this graphite electrode. And this is the degradation profiling that was done. Initially, we can see that the TP4, that is the transformation product 4 and transformation product 1 was accumulating, and later on it can get converted into TP2 and TP3. And so we can conclude here that the cytosine and the chlorinated forms of cytokine were identified as a major byproduct from the LCMS study. And though cytosine is having a lower toxicity than the cytokine, but the products which are chlorinated, so they may be more toxic, they may be more dangerous in comparison to cytokine. So that is the main, we can say, the conclusions. So as Professor Mukherjee also told, that it is very, very important that we analyze that how the, though we are going for the oxidation of this drug by using different methods, for example, we used here the graphite electrode, but it is possible that the byproducts which are forming, they may be more toxic than what is the parent compound. So that has to be seen. And we have to look forward for the method by which we can completely remove these products also, so that we can remove the complete mineralization of this drug. So with this, I stop my talk here. I thank you. Thank you to all.
So thank you, Professor Sinha. So I request attendees to put their question in Q&A, and we will do all the things during the panel discussion. And with this, I just thank Professor Sinha, and I would like to invite Professor Tiwari from IIT Kharagpur so he can start sharing his slide. And meanwhile, I will give a brief introduction. So Professor Manoj Kumar Tiwari, he has done his B.Tech from Pantnagar, G.B. Pantnagar, and then M.Tech and Ph.D. from IIT Kanpur. In his M.Tech, he worked with the USB reactors for wastewater treatment. And in his Ph.D., he was working on the sorption and degradation of the indosulfan and the chloropyrifos. After that, he moved to USA for a postdoctoral studies as a Fulbright fellow. And after that, he joined IIT Kharagpur as an assistant professor in the School of Water Resources. He has won many awards during his career, and also he was a very good with the academics. He won silver medal in the Pantnagar University. And he has many travel grants and CAS awards from different agencies. His area is, at present, he's working in a fate and transport of pollutants in water and soil medium, treatment of hazardous and persistent pollutants in surface and groundwater, contaminated site management, wastewater treatment, also using advanced oxidation processes. And he also a part in a water quality sensor development. So with this, I would like to invite Professor Tiwari, and today he's going to talk about a microbial degradation of these non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So welcome, Professor Tiwari. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Professor Satyantra. And I hope I'm audible. Can someone confirm?
Yes, you are audible, Professor Tiwari. Please.
Thank you. Yeah. So thank you. Thank you, Satyantra. And first, I will thank Professor Mukherjee and Professor Alok as well, because they have already set the tone right. And somehow, like on the name of emerging contaminants today, we all are speaking on the pharmaceuticals. And I am also the next in the line. So what I'm going to speak is on the microbial degradation of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which are basically NSAIDs. Okay. We already had this background of what are the pharmaceuticals and personal care product as they basically, because as I said that all my previous couple of speakers have also, in fact, spoken on the pharmaceuticals. So we can realize that how important this has become and how much research attention it is seeking in the name of emerging contaminants, because emerging contaminants is a wide class. There are pesticides, there are pharmaceuticals, there are various other stuff. But one of the major focus of the research community is towards these PPCPs, which are pharmaceuticals and personal care products. Now, under these, like Professor Mukherjee has worked on a wide range of pharmaceuticals, and what she shared mainly like on the antibiotics and some other class of pharmaceuticals. And right before me, Professor Sinha in fact spoke on the cancer drugs. So what I'm going to talk is on the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, which are popularly known as NSAIDs. So these NSAIDs are in fact one of the most used pharmaceuticals. It's wide nature of uses, because many of like ibuprofen, I'm sure all of you might have ibuprofen, dexamethasone under NSAIDs, and many of these are simple pain, considered as simple painkillers, and that's why they are available for purchase without prescription, and that has kind of made the uses of these comps, which are available only on the description.
Prasad Tiwari, can you hear me?
So, it's basically this reason it constitutes the most significant group of pharmaceutically active substances. Okay, and it's detected in the rivers, lakes. Yes.
Yeah, so I have.
Hello.
Yeah, Professor Tiwari, there is some voice break, so I off your video. So probably it will be okay. Please
okay,
go
that's
ahead.
Okay. Yeah. That's okay. Yeah, but I hope you can hear me.
Yes, now I can. We can hear you. There was a break, voice break, so that's why I have stopped
okay,
you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, absolutely no problem. So what I was mentioning that...
it's not in full screen. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So what I was mentioning is that because of the reason that the NSAIDs are easily available without prescription, these are one of the most significant group of the pharmaceutically active substances, and they are kind of omnipresent. Okay, they're like they occur in the aquatic environment. Almost detected in the rivers, lakes, drinking water sources, the wastewater, everywhere. And due to their health and environmental impacts, they are considered as chronic ecotoxic substances. So the sources for exposure of these compounds are already, in fact, being discussed by Professor Mukherjee as well as Professor Alok. So I will skip this. Okay. So some of the popular NSAIDs that we see in the market are like diclofenac, ibuprofen, naproxen, ketoprofen. So these are some of the most common NSAIDs, and these are their like the standard typical properties. Now, as I said, that they are widely detected in almost all aquatic mediums across the world. So this is kind of a summary of the range of the compounds detected based on whatever we could review from different countries. So you can see that like in Australia, US, UK, India, Italy, Germany, France, China, Canada, Brazil, means we could list few only, like it is present in almost everywhere. And the concentration ranges varies from very low level, like maybe nanogram or even less than the nanogram level, because for many places it has been reported below detection limit, to substantially higher levels as well. Okay, so like you can see the highlighted ones are probably the one of the higher side of the concentrations. Okay, so like up to 32 microgram per liter naproxen, or like 30 microgram per liter ibuprofen, close to like 0.2 milligram per liter diclofenac. So these are the concentrations present in the water, natural waters. We are not talking about the sewage or other streams, because there it's far more higher. But even in the natural waters, the rivers, similar way, like we can find the concentrations in the lake where there is a huge effect of the dilution as well. Still, we are able to get the concentration in or up to, in some cases, like a milligram per liter as well. So these compounds have a variety of health impacts, which basically could be like sometime it's just mild impact, and sometime it actually quite intensive as well. And one of the reasons for being these compounds detected in water aquatic mediums is their high water solubility. So once they come in the water, they basically like solubility is quite high. So they do not like easily get absorbed or retained onto the sediments in the natural water bodies, okay, or even in the waste streams, because of the higher solubility of these compounds. So if you talk about the treatment of or removal of NSAIDs, there are conventional wastewater treatment plants which do remove certain degree of NSAIDs. Professor Mukherjee also earlier discussed that the wastewater treatment plants, like various type of wastewater treatment plants have variable degree of removal of the pharmaceuticals, and NSAIDs is one such class which actually gets removed in the conventional or typical wastewater treatment plants as well. But the problem is that the removal is inconsistent and unreliable. Okay, so we may see very high degree of removal at some places or some time, but we have like the contradictory reports as well where removal is very low. Then if it doesn't get removed in the conventional wastewater treatment plant, we do look for the specific or advanced treatment options or tertiary treatment options. And there are advanced oxidation processes like Fenton oxidation, electrochemical oxidation, or other advanced oxidation process, like right before me, Professor Sinha discussed one. Then there are adsorbent, like activated carbon or various synthetic resins, which are used for the removal of these compounds. There are membrane filtrations, nanofiltration and RO kind of system have also been used. So most of these are actually reported to be very effective. Okay, but in generally, like these, the physicochemical processes, high-end physicochemical process like adsorbents, membrane filtration or AOPs are considered expensive and have relatively large ecological footprint. And due to these reasons, microbial degradation is also being explored heavily as a potential method to eliminate these NSAIDs from the waters. So first, when as we were saying that basically there is a removal from the conventional treatment or variety of like wastewater treatment plants as well. So you can see like we have tried to list out from the literature the quite a few wastewater treatment plants and how effective they have been in removing these NSAIDs. So you can see that some has done very good. Okay, like you see that these concentrations are in nanogram per liter. So some has been able to bot it to very low level from reasonably high level. But again, even with the low level, even with the good degree of removal, there are still the concentrations are very high at times. Okay, and which are good enough to cause potential threat to the discharge bodies where basically we are releasing this treated effluent, okay? Or if we are reusing this treated effluent for certain applications. So like from different treatment plant, these are kind of summary of those. So I'll like just skip it. Briefly, like adsorptive removal, again, there are variety of mechanism for the adsorption, okay? And sort of like the different compounds can be adsorbed on to the following the different mechanisms as well. But anyway, we'll not focus much on to these options or like AOPs, which has already been discussed, or membrane filtrations. What we are going to talk about is the microbial degradation. So microbial degradation of NSAIDs, what we are actually referring to. So they have been extensively studied from pure culture of various microbial strains, particularly bacteria. There has been few studies on like fungal culture as well, but they are just limited to a few studies. So most studies have focused the various aerobic microbial species. And there is like quite a few substantial amount of literature is available on that. So how typically people proceed, like this in fact from one of our studies. So like the bacteria is typically associated isolated from the culture from a medium which is already these compounds, like generally the soil around a hospital discharge site, okay, or pharmaceutical industry discharge site, okay, or those sort of places, like we take that and then we isolate the pure strains. We go for identification of the strain. And what basically we try to do in one of our studies is taking several strains. We try to feed with the diclofenac and in the presence and absence of acetate. Okay. And it was observed that in the, like, if there was no acetate, which is basically the, which was acting as a primary substrate in that case, we could not see any, but when there was acetate present, quite a few strains were very not effective there as well, but quite a few strains were very effective in removal of the diclofenac. So these kind of like studies are done. So if we like removal, people have seen for the major different exposure to the different microbial species. So we can see that the there are like several studies which report very good removal, almost 100% removal or close, like more than 90% removal at different varying concentrations for diclofenac. Similarly, we can for other compounds as well. These, when they go on to decompose, as Professor Alok and Professor Mukherjee also mentioned, that for any organic compound, complex organic compound, when it is undergoes some sort of degradation, either physicochemical or degradation, there will be a series of metabolites will be formed. Some of them might be toxic, some of them might be like having lesser environment. There are quite a few popular metabolites which are reported, okay. And we have, what in fact we have seen is we have used the molecular softwares, like when a complex molecule like say diclofenac or other stuff gets broken down, what are the possible, depending on the energy that we are providing, what are the possible metabolites that can be formed? And many of them have never been tested also. Surprisingly, I don't have much of results to show on that front, but we have been able to get the theoretical breakdown species which could be present, figure out that why it has not been reported. Is it because nobody have like given the attention to detect that, or is it because their subsequent decomposition, because there is a possibility that a species is being formed, but the subsequent decomposition under certain condition is very rapid. So in that case also, that those species cannot be detected. Ibuprofen also have been tested under various microbial systems, okay, in a pure culture, in fact. And the degradation efficiency, in fact, again shows a varied response from as low as around 40% to as high as 92%. These are similarly some of the major metabolites that are obtained out of ibuprofen. Similarly, like the other this thing and their metabolites. Now there are various studies on the mixed culture microbial degradation of the NSAIDs as well. So instead of like just going for one pure strain, go for multiple pure strains. So like if you see in the single culture, the ibuprofen has not been very effective. The removal of ibuprofen means it ranged from 41% to 92%, but it was like never reported to go to the like complete removal. But under mixed consortium, there are studies which report the 100% removal of ibuprofen, ketoprofen, or diclofenac. So like variety of these things has been tested and found to be like completely removed under the mixed culture system. So there are like possibility to use the mixed culture, but again, the maintaining the mixed culture or pure culture, and even if it's a mixed consortium, in what proportion that mixed consortium should be used is of very high importance. So if we talk about the degradation pathways were there, so the first major route of primary decomposition is hydroxylation, And that has been basically identified as the rate limiting step in most of the studies. So around 70 to 75% of these compounds first undergo hydroxylation, and then there are like demethylation or coenzyme elimination has also been reported as a first part. And then there are subsequently like the secondary processes, subsequent processes, which are oxidation or the kind of dechlorination, dehydrogenation. So there are like a variety of other processes which take place the different route. Among the secondary processes, the major one is oxidation and dehydrogenation, hydroxylation. So these are the kind of major processes under the secondary group. So overall, like if we see the applicability and limitation of the bioremediation processes for NSAIDs, focusing particularly on the NSAIDs. So although like from lab scale, we have seen as under mixed culture or the sometime even with the pure culture, we have seen very promising results, very good removal efficiency, but full scale application, similar to like many other processes, the full scale application of these processes or the biotic removal systems for like specific, of course, in the wastewater treatment plants, there are some removal happens, but the specific or tertiary NSAIDs have not been installed at many places. They are very limited, though there are a few pilot and even a couple of full-scale installations are also there. But again, like it's not popularized yet. While basically when we try to translate this technology or scale up this technology to the wastewater treatment plant level or WWTP level, there is a few kind of focus on, and then that. So maintaining like space under the transient condition of the actual treatment facilities. Okay, as we said that pure culture or a combination of culture can be useful, but maintaining that combination of culture or pure culture in the specific proportions in the system under real condition is not that easy as we achieve in the laboratory conditions. So that has to be kind of ensured if we want to scale up to the field level application and achieve the performances as we do in the labs. The pathway also, like the pathways are mostly reported for the pure strains or at some time even the mixed strains, but they cannot be generalized when we have, when we basically bring this into the in-field operation. Okay. Again, the like maintaining a pure or mixed culture, basically relevant sterility environment is needed, because if we are planning to, there would be some degree of removal at the WWT, like the conventional ASP or that processes. But if we specifically want a setup for removal of the leftover NSAIDs using the bioculture, as we have been seeing earlier, so in that case, if you want to maintain a pure, means a specific culture, either it's a pure or a mixed culture, we need to ensure that the effluent that reaches to that stage is devoid of the earlier microbial population. So there needs to be a basically prime for this type of application as a tertiary stage. And then because we are doing a biotic system, so after this treatment also, we need another round of disinfection. So basically, we need two rounds of disinfection, and this will increase the treatment cost. Particularly if we are going for chlorine disinfection, let's say as a primary round, then we must ensure that there is no residual chlorine left, because that can again hamper your bioprocess. So if chlorine is being used as a disinfection, so then after primary disinfection, we need to again ensure that the residual chlorine is also removed. So otherwise there is a chances of failure of these systems, even if we apply them in a very cautious way. Okay. in hospital or pharmaceutical effluents, these the microbes which can act upon those higher concentrations are needed. So they have to have a very high minimum inhibitory concentration, whereas very few microbial strains have shown to this level of the MIC. There are more, like several cultures or several strains available which can degrade these compounds at the relevant concentrations, but for high doses there would be like difficulty, so appropriate dilution might be used in order to tackle these issues. Okay. Another problem is the NSAIDs are mostly like have been more effectively removed when they are used as a co-substrate or under co-metabolic conditions. Okay. As a, there are very few strains identified which can survive on the pure NSAIDs as a carbon source. Okay. So, and that too, like not the demol efficiency have never been reported to 100% for those strains. So in order to like, if we want to achieve the effective removal of these, we need to ensure that we identify the appropriate strains and what is the primary substrate suitable for that. Again, in lab experiments, we do add acetate or glucose or phenolic compounds as a primary substrate. But in real systems, there is already, there might be already like organic carbon present in the system. So we have to again explore that whether the real BOD present in the waste stream can be used as a primary substrate for these. If not, then again we need to like see if we really need to add additional substrate, how effective, means what is the cost aspect of that, okay, and with what minimum doses, whether it is whether it is cost effective and feasible to add additional substrate. Okay. And another major limitation is basically the lack of studies relating to the NSAID in presence of the metabolites. Okay. So mainly like the major compound degradation is studied, but what happens to the metabolites, as our earlier speakers have also basically pointed out this, that the removal means of parent compound may not be sufficient. We have to track the complete pathway in order to see whether it is completely mineralizing or it compound or is into some other form. These are some of the like application and limitation challenges, and with this I conclude this talk.
Thank you, Professor Tiwari. And as I told, like there are many relevant questions in question answer, but we will take just after the final presentation. So thank you, Professor Tiwari. And now I would like to invite Professor Srivastava. And he can start sharing his slides. And meanwhile, I will give his brief introduction. And as like our earlier speakers, they have talked about mostly on the pharmaceuticals. And now here, Professor Srivastava is going to talk on a different kind of emerging contaminant, which is microplastic as an emerging contaminant in the environment. So Professor Srivastava has done his BTech from Mathura, from Hindustan College of Science, Science and Technology. And later he done his MTech and PhD both from Environmental Engineering from IIT Kanpur. And he done his postdoc from Durban Institute of Technology. And then he joined IIT Bombay as an assistant professor. And here mainly he is working on advanced oxidation processes of degradation of emerging contaminants such as antibiotics and other drugs. Also, he is working in algal biorefinery for the biofuel production, algal bacterial photobioreactors, biological nutrient removals, fate and transport of pollutant in the natural environments, photocatalytic degradation of pesticide using eco-friendly and low-cost homogeneous catalyst. And along with that, he has started working on microplastic and a few years before his article on microplastic, where he has shows the microplastic concentration in different salts, I think from 6 or 7 different companies. And he has shown a sufficient level of microplastic in those salts, the edible salts. So with this, I would like to invite Professor Srivastava, and he will talk on this microplastics. So welcome, Professor Srivastava. Floor is yours now. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Singh, for this very generous introduction. Am I audible?
You are audible, Professor Srivastava.
Okay. Please. So how much time do I have?
So you can try to wind up in 15 to 20 minutes.
Okay. Thank you. So a very good morning to all of the people who are present in this conference today. And I thank the organizers for inviting me to this panel and talk about some important aspects. So what I'm going to talk about now in this talk is about the microplastics, and it is becoming a major concern in past 5 to 6 years. Lot of global attention is being paid. Of course, the microplastics have been in discussion amongst the scientific communities as early as 1970s, but it is only since 2010-12 onwards that most of the global scientific community is now paying a lot of attention to the microplastics, and they are also being termed as the emerging contaminant. So before we start, since it is about the plastic, I think most of us know that plastic is a very durable product, useful product. And in a time of current pandemic, plastic has come as a savior for the life of many people and so on. However, it is the unscientific disposal of plastic into our environmental bodies, which results in a lot of environmental issues. And I'm sure most of you have actually seen these kind of situations where the unscientifically disposed plastic items, both on the terrestrial environment as well as in the marine environment, they result in kind of various issues, biotic losses or biodiversity losses. So when the size of these plastic particles are very large, then these kind of effects are very evident. However, it may also happen that the particle size or the size of these plastics are so low that we are not able to observe them with our naked eye. But however, even if they are very small in size, they still persist in the environment, and they also cause a lot of environmental issues. So here, what I'm showing is that these green fluorescent particles that you are observing is the microplastic particles, which are smaller than size in few micrometer size and all. And once they are present in the aquatic body, there are various organisms. For example, this is a zooplankton who has ingested this microplastic. So you are observing these fluorescent particles within the body. And then it is also prone for biotic transfer or trophic transfer. So here the same zooplankton has then been ingested by a crab, and then you are observing the same fluorescing microplastic particles within the body of crab who has not primarily ingested it. So what I am showing here is that the problem of plastic or the unscientific disposal of plastic in environment does not end at the macro level. It also converts to various micro level issues, and which we are not accounting or concerned about at present. So this is what brings us to the concept of microplastics. These are called as emerging contaminants, which are persistent and they are pervasive environmental pollutants, and people have reported their presence in almost all environmental matrices. Typically, we define a microplastic as a plastic particle which is within this size range, 1 micrometer to 5 millimeter. And because there are too many different varieties of plastic with environmental processes, too many different colors and sizes and shapes come. So you have these microplastics heterogeneously distributed all across the environmental matrices. some example of their presence in various matrices is here you can see they are also present in terrestrial environment. People have also reported the presence of microplastics in Arctic and Antarctic where no application of plastic is reported. Similarly, we also find microplastics present in oceans as well as the deep ocean beds. So these microplastics are basically coming from two sources. They are either primary microplastic, meaning they are manufactured in that small size range and they are being used in various personal care products and so on. So they are manufactured in this particular size range, and also they come in environment as secondary microplastic, where the larger macroplastics are degraded, they are fragmented into small particles, which are of this smaller size range. And these are called as the secondary microplastics. So in our environment, we find both kind of primary as well as secondary microplastics. So how these microplastics are generated, and once they are generated, how they enter into the environmental body. So as I already mentioned, you have the plastic being manufactured in the larger size, so which we call as the macroplastics. Then we have the manufacturing of synthetic textiles, and then we also have manufacturing of primary plastics or microplastics. So once these different varieties are unscientifically disposed into the environment, because after the societal use, then they will simply undergo some kind of environmental processes, for example, the degradation and so on. And then eventually they will accumulate both on the terrestrial environment in soils or enter in the water streams. If they are entering directly into the water stream, then they will enter the freshwater streams or ecosystems and affect the organisms which are living there. And they can also enter the sewage and then reach our wastewater treatment facilities, where depending on the type of treatment that we are using, they may either go into the treated wastewater stream or in the sludge. So with the application of this sludge and all, they can again enter the terrestrial environment, or with the treated effluent, they may reach our aquatic bodies again. And depending on the processes, fate and transport, which is happening in these bodies, they may eventually enter into the marine environment, where most of our microplastics, they are getting accumulated. So this is also becoming a very important issue of concern, where the presence of microplastics in the oceans is continuously increasing. There are various processes which result in the contribution of microplastic in the ocean. Some of them I already mentioned, where the freshwater bodies like rivers and all, they take all these microplastics from our societal needs and all, and they carry it forward to the oceans. And then depending on the type of microplastics, the plastic properties, the governing environmental processes, they may distribute either on the top layer or they may sink to the bottom. And then depending on other dominant phenomena, they may either get degraded further or they may also be then prone for ingestion by other organisms which are present. And eventually trophic transfer is also a reality nowadays. So the issue has become so important nowadays, particularly of microplastics and plastic as a whole, that nowadays people have observed that there are some if you would have heard this term, Great Pacific Garbage Patch, where the garbage, or which is predominantly plastic, the accumulation of the plastic is so much in some locations, where the entire surface area which is being covered by the garbage itself ranges up to the surface area of at least 2 to 3 European countries. So you can consider how much amount of garbage, predominantly plastic, we are releasing into our environment. And then once this is in the environment, it comes back to haunt us. So once these microplastics are released into the environment, then there are some non-trivial technologies and processes using which we have to estimate. So these can be present either in the biological samples after the fish, mussels, they have ingested it and it is present in their tissues and all, or it may be present in the wastewater, it may be present in the water sample, sediment sample, and nowadays people are also observing the presence of microplastics in air. So once you have a sample in which a microplastics needs to be estimated, some preparation or analysis is required before it can be analyzed on some sophisticated instruments for getting the counts as well as identification of the microplastics. So these pre-separation steps include dissection, in situ sieving and all, and all these have certain limitations as well. After that, if it is coming from the environmental sample, then there will be a lot more contamination from other organic matter and inorganic matter. So you need to separate these microplastics out of the other contaminating interfering agents or materials. So you have then various separation methods, for example, density separation, digestion, filtration. I will not be talking more about these, but all these separation methods are also very important, and your final estimation of microplastics depends on whether you have used a proper separation method or not. Otherwise, whatever you are counting will be just an overestimation of the actual count. Once you have separated the microplastic from the environmental sample, then we can either go for simple stereo microscope to observe and count the plastic particles. But again, there are certain limitations. For example, with certain simple microscopy, we are not able to identify the type of chemical composition that is present on the particle. So for that, we need to go for other sophisticated instrumentations, which are non-trivial to operate and optimize. So these vibrational spectroscopy, which include Raman microscopy as well as FTIR, they are good for a micrometer size range for microplastics. But if you have even smaller plastic particles, which we call as nanoplastics, then these Raman and FTIR will not work. Then we will have to go for mass spectroscopy based methods. For example, this TDS GCMS and pyrolysis GCMS. So this analysis and estimation is very complicated, and it is not trivial to work with. So once these microplastics are present in the environment, then they also undergo various degradation because of natural processes. So you may either have larger microscopic plastics or even the primary microplastics. Once they are in the environment, there are various environmental processes which will then work on these plastic particles and result in their degradation and fragmentation. So UV radiation, photolysis, thermal radiation, oxidative degradation, and biodegradation are some predominant mechanisms through which these microplastic particles are degraded in natural environment. So after this, you may have, after all these processes have worked on the microplastic, then you may have certain kind of effect on the surface as well as the bulk of the plastic particles. For example, it may undergo some surface morphological changes, further fragmentation may happen, and density changes may also happen. So idea is, if the natural degradation is not complete, it is just a fraction of amount that is getting degraded, then there are also chances of getting some intermediate degradation products generated from these plastics, and which may also be more toxic, or those kind of issues are also to be addressed. One important concern for this is that these plastic, eventually the microplastic, they also carry a lot of additives present on them. So all these processes, they may also make these additives more bioavailable because of the leaching off, which may happen after the surface properties have changed. So along with the primary plastic material, we then also have to worry about the issues which will be associated with the leaching of these plastic additives. In addition to these additives, nowadays people have also reported that these microplastic particles are also a carrier for various heavy metals as well as pathogens. So we may also have to worry about the behavior and the leaching effect of these other secondary contaminants from the microplastics. So why do we actually bother about the presence of microplastics in the environment is because of the concern and associated risk of human exposure to the microplastics. So there are mostly four major pathways through which human get exposed to these microplastics. You may either be exposed with the food that is contaminated with microplastic, or with the drinking water, which is contaminated with microplastic, or inhalation if you are inhaling the air which is contaminated with microplastic, or even the dermal exposure. Out of all these four, our dermal exposure is considered to be an insignificant pathway in comparison to other three: food, drinking water, and inhalation. So I will talk about these three dominant pathways in this talk. So there are a lot of studies which have reported the contamination of our various food items with the microplastics. So this raises a concern that the presence of microplastic with food and exposure with the ingestion is a reality. Similarly, from various parts of the world, people have reported the contamination of drinking water. It may be either the bottled water or after coming from drinking water treatment, or even the groundwater. So people have reported the presence of these microplastics in all these drinking water sources. And World Health Organization also has come up with a very good report in 2019, where they actually summarize all the work that has been done so far on the presence of microplastic in drinking water. Similarly, people have also reported the presence of microplastic in the atmospheric air. So with this, the human exposure to microplastic is a reality, and people have also done some estimation as to how much amount of microplastic we are actually exposed to annually. So they are reporting from consumption, ingestion, and drinking water, anywhere around 40,000 microplastic particles to 60,000 microplastic particles in a year. Similarly, if you are breathing the contaminated air, then the concentration or the exposure may range anywhere from 0 to 120,000 particles per year. And this is also been primarily reported also by some, there are some studies which have been conducted in some European countries where people they have taken the human excreta and then identified the presence of microplastic in human excreta. So it suggests that humans are in fact exposed to microplastic, and the microplastic is entering the human body. So once it is known that we are exposed, we are ingesting the microplastic, then we need to know about what are the associated health effects. So with the health effects of organisms of microplastics on various organisms like fish and all has been comprehensively investigated by the researchers. And with those studies, they have reported two major pathways. It can either be the physical effect or the chemical effect, which may be both sublethal and lethal. However, I must acknowledge that so far our understanding of the health effects of microplastic is coming only from marine organisms or some terrestrial organisms, not directly from the humans. So all these health effects that we talk about of microplastics on humans are still speculative in nature. But with this understanding, people have also speculated various kind of health effects which may humans will also be eventually develop. For example, the skin irritation all the way to reproductive and cancer effects. And some in vitro evidence has also been gathered where scientists have exposed various human cell cultures to various concentrations of micro and nanoplastics of polyethylene and polystyrene. And they have also reported that some toxic effects are observed on human cell lines also. So that gives a first of the in vitro evidence for the health effects of microplastics on humans as well. So to summarize the talk, the unscientific disposal of plastic has resulted in the accumulation of microplastics in most environmental matrices, even in those places where there is no history of plastic application, for example, our polar regions and all. And identification and quantification of these microplastics is non-trivial, and there is sufficient data available that suggests human exposure and ingestion of microplastics, and direct evidences of health effects are available only for some other organisms, not for humans. However, these in vitro studies do suggest cytotoxicity to humans. However, we still require much more understanding, much more studies before we can actually estimate the comprehensive risk assessment of microplastics to humans in particular. So with that, I conclude my talk. Thank you for your attention, and I hand over to Professor Singh now.
Thank you, Professor Srivastava. And with this, first, I request all the attendees to put their question in question and answer. So before starting the question and answer, I just would like to summarize the full talk given by our panelists. So first start with Professor Mukherjee. He has talked about on emerging contaminants, especially on the pharmaceuticals, what the way the different treatment like the plants, they are not able to effectively deal with that. She has talked about the importance of quantification and how challenging is this and what kind of different methods should be used, such as isotope level standards. And also she had talked about what we are facing while extracting and because of the metabolism formation. One thing also interesting, she had talked about after the concentration of these pollutants, these emerging pharmaceuticals in influent and effluent, where some of them have shown higher concentration after the treatment. She also talked about a photocatalytic degradation of the some of these pollutant, and also the development of new sensors where we can sense these pharmaceuticals, which are going to really help to monitor and do take the certain decision how we are going to deal with that. The second speaker, Professor Alok Sinha, has talked about the anti-cancer drug degradation with the electrochemical degradation. He has talked about different kind of cytostatic drugs, how they are they can be degraded, what are the major metabolites or the species are forming during the degradation. He has shown, he has used different electrodes such as copper and graphite, also talked about what is the role of pH and on the degradation. And one thing was quite interesting, which he has discussed, is the formation of chlorinated byproducts, which are going to show a much more, probably much more health effect as compared to the normal byproducts. So that shows the if we have chlorine in the water and we are going for these electrochemical degradation, and the formation of chlorine is the major reactive chlorine is the major pathway to degrade this contaminant, but that is going to create the problem. After that, our third speaker, Professor Tiwari, he has talked about these NSAIDs type of drugs, the anti-inflammatory drugs degradation. He has nicely put it the how the other treatment technologies has certain drawbacks and why should we take care of these biological processes. He had given the examples using pure and mixed culture. We can do these degradation of these class of contaminants or the these drugs. And also, but at the last, he has talked about the different challenges if we want to implement into the wastewater treatment plant. And he has nicely shown the degradation pathway, how these organisms, their microorganisms, they are degrading these contaminants. And our fourth and last speaker, Professor Srivastava, has talked about the microplastic. He has nicely put it like how one of the important thing, the polymers, the plastics, which helped us a lot, but because of our careless disposal, we are facing a new threat. He has talked about the fate and transport of these plastic in ecosystem, how they are from the rivers, they are reaching into the ocean and then creating a kind of problem. He had talked about Great Pacific Garbage Patch, which is a size of 2-3 European countries. So you can understand the size of this garbage pack. He has talked about challenges for his estimation, how difficult to even detect these microplastics and extraction from different kind of matrices. And if we want to go for nanoplastics, then how these things can create problem. At last, he talked about the exposure to the human, and he pointed out most of our he given like the data, like how much plastic every day we are consuming. But the mostly the most important thing he pointed out, the most of the studies are based on the animals, especially the sea species. And on the basis of that, we are able to just guess the human health effect. So with this, I will start with the question answer. So I will go one by one. So first, there was one question for Professor Mukherjee, where they were asking regarding how other than this carbamazepine, like what kind of other kind of pharmaceuticals can seen in higher concentration after the treatment. So Professor Mukherjee. Yeah. Professor Mukherjee, can you hear us?
Yeah, so carbamazepine is what we found was present in a higher concentration. But there can be several other which actually whatever is excreted from our body in conjugated form and then subsequently gets deconjugated during the treatment and for which the degradation is also low. Those are the type of compounds for which we will may see higher concentrations subsequently after treatment. At the present, I'm unable to name specific ones because we found this particularly for carbamazepine, again, which is widely reported as the most persistent as an anti-epileptic drug. Sorry, I can't name any specific ones right now. But whichever are excreted in a conjugated form and subsequently gets converted back to the parent form, but is not degraded. Those are the things that has to be satisfied for it to be at a higher concentration.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. There is another question, like till what, how much of these pharmaceuticals are safe in drinking water?
Okay, so what in drinking water, if you look at the type of concentrations in India, I haven't seen specific values, but in, for example, the type of measurements reported by Professor Padhya based on US drinking water, etc., nanogram per liter levels, those are actually lower than the predicted no effects concentration. So we do not expect at that level if it is only present as a pure component. But what happens is often they are present as a mixture of pharmaceutical. No individual pharmaceutical may be higher than the predicted no effect concentration in the environment. But what happens is when they are present together, there's a likelihood of the additive and synergistic effects. Of course, we can also have antagonistic effect lowering their effect. But the complexity is that many, many pharmaceuticals are present at a very low concentration and their effects may be additive. No single one is present at so high a level that is, or we already know that the effect is there. It is that.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. So the next question is for Professor Sinha, where the question is like, have you tried to see the hydrogen peroxide generation? And have you also tried to do these experiments in absence of chlorine, not using sodium chloride, you using sodium sulfate? So Professor Sinha.
We have not used sodium, we have used only sodium chloride for our spectacles, these experiments, and we have not tried sodium sulfate instead. So we can, in the long run, we can try so other electrolytes also, so that we can see that whether these chlorinated products are being formed or not. So that we may try in coming this thing. But still we have not tried it. We have only seen what is the effect of NaCl on the degradation of this cytokine. Okay, and for H2O2 generation, we have not seen, but we have seen that dot-OH radicals, we have seen that how dot-OH radicals are being formed in the solutions.
Thank you, Professor Sinha. Sir, this question is from my side. So if we able to come up with certain method where we can reduce the formation of chlorine, reactive chlorine species, so we'll able to help to reduce this formation of these chlorinated byproducts.
Yes, yes. So that can be one of the major things, that if we can reduce the formation of these chlorinated byproducts, then it is possible. And if we can go achieve more mineralization instead of forming this product formation, chlorine product byproduct formation, then it will be better that we can say that the complete removal of the this drug can has taken place. So that we see. That is the real challenge.
Thank you, Professor Sinha. So the next question is for Professor Tiwari, where the question is from a resident from Ladakh, and he wants to know, like, nowadays there is some less number of the vultures are seen in Kargil Ladakh area. So is there any connection between use of these antibiotic painkiller and other steroid injection used in animals for the reason for this number going down for these vultures and other things?
I actually cannot certainly say anything on this because see, there are number of vultures, or for that matter a lot other birds and other animals are going down at many places, not only in the Ladakh. Okay. And that has to basically that is probably presumably the result of several factors. I don't know exactly how much is the contribution of the pharmaceutical pollutants in that sense. Okay. Because how there is no direct correlation I could establish between the pharmaceutical levels of pharmaceuticals in the dead animals on which vultures survive, okay, to the vultures. I means it's very difficult to answer that.
Can I make a comment?
Yes, sure, Professor.
Actually, the vultures feed on carcasses, the dead bodies, and in many cases, a lot of NSAIDs etc. are used in animals, and as a result of that, often there is concentration in the bodies of the vultures, further bioconcentration. And diclofenac is one such pharmaceutical that has been associated with excessive concentration in vultures, which caused toxicity to them, as a result of which a lot of vulture population declined. So, but it was an effect based not from water, but from carcasses that they were feeding on. So similarly for sparrows, etc., I saw the question, most likely it is insecticides and pesticides that are being used in the grains they feed upon. So most likely the food has a greater impact there rather than the things in water. So that's just a comment from what I think.
So thank you, Professor Mukherjee and Professor Tiwari.
Actually, there has been a contradictory reports also on this, particularly on the vultures and diclofenac. As Professor Mukherjee pointed out, there are a few reports related to that, but there has been a contradiction also published onto this, that the ability of vultures to accumulate and assimilate diclofenac is not is sufficient enough to kind of not let that harmful effect which has been reported by few. Okay. So probably I would say there could be effect, but it's not that.
So thank you, Professor Tiwari. So the next question is again from your presentation. So what factor need to consider to construct an effective microbial consortia for NSAID treatment, as most of strain are not able to grow together?
Yes. So what happens basically, see, in lab studies, they isolate the different species, different specific species, and then in many of the studies, what they do, those who are effective in removal or in degradation of these NSAIDs in single, so they try to club them and in order to see their synergistic or antagonistic effect on that. So yes, few of them would not gel with other whereas few has synergistic effect as well. So that is the reason that mixed culture may sometimes give you the better output and may sometimes actually give you the give you kind of inhibitory outputs as well. Okay, so how this is typically done in the field? So it has to come out of individual, like the progressive development studies have to be carried out with maybe like if you want to come up with a very good and effective culture, you start with the see, there are two ways people sometimes start with isolation of the pure strains and added then go on to merging them, and many times like people start with the mixed culture itself and then they keep on feeding the NSAIDs or for that matter any other compound, and progressively those who cannot live in that medium or that inhibit, so the synergistic effect or better acclimatization with that consortia for to be used in the field, and then other specific or individualized identification can be done through the isolation and then subsequent sequencing and identification.
So thank you, Professor Tiwari. So the next question is, can we not use the plants for degrading these pharmaceuticals? So anyone can try, Professor Mukherjee, please. So it's kind of phytoremediation of these pharmaceuticals.
Yes, to some extent that should be possible, although I have not specifically done anything about in this area or read, but it should be possible. In fact, there are certain enzymes that may be there in which may have some activity. But again, I do not personally know much about the effect of plants.
So the another question where it's asked, like there are different technology has been discussed for degradation of these contaminants. So which one is the best and what is recommended for the degradation of these pharmaceutical in wastewater?
So what I would say is we need to realize that pharmaceuticals removal in just secondary treatment, primary and secondary alone, is unlikely to be adequate. So it is better to add an appropriate tertiary process, which may be an advanced oxidation-based process or a membrane-based process, which is effective in removing the pharmaceuticals. So, and the other thing we need to realize is the sludge handling, because the sludge is likely to have pharmaceuticals associated with it if our wastewater has the sludge, has the pharmaceuticals. So there is a likelihood of leaching of pharmaceuticals subsequently from the sludge if we are thinking of land applications and things like that. So I think it is a main awareness and management of biosolids, et cetera, that also needs to come in along with the addition of appropriate processes to treat the, remove the pharmaceuticals better. Another thing that we can think of is if there is possibility of pharmaceuticals in our drinking water due to presence of such chemicals in our water bodies, we can add some processes like adsorption or biofiltration to remove the pharmaceuticals in the water treatment train. So those are some thoughts.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. So now I also, for the same question, I want to know the opinion of Professor Sinha, Professor Tiwari, and Professor Srivastava as well.
From my side, I think we have to also look to the specific pharmaceuticals that are present in the wastewater, and then we can have different methods for different type of these pharmaceuticals. So we have to see that what type of pharmaceuticals can be degraded easily by which method. So that you have to study. It's a matter of study that how easily it can be degraded and up to what extent it can be degraded and what are the degradation byproducts that will be forming from the degradation. So that needs to be studied, and then only we can recommend anything for a specific treatment for a certain pharmaceutical. I think from my
Thank you, Professor Sinha. Professor Tiwari?
Yeah, I actually agree with what Professor Mukherjee and Professor Sinha said. And in fact, not only just for pharmaceuticals, but for any means for majority of emerging contaminants, it's very difficult to point out any single treatment system as best, because we need to see what are the concentrations, what are the requirements, what are the system we are treating for, what are the scenarios like, and where we are treating the budget available, feasibility. And many times what we see that instead of just using a single system, it is better to use more than one system in conjugation. Let's say like if we feel that the concentration is very high and the level of the concentration needed, or the like if you want to go for a complete elimination of that substance, there are high energy physicochemical systems which can give us the desired output, and biological system alone will fail there. But that the cost of the physicochemical system might be very high. So it might be advisable to go for a natural or low cost systems to get, say, 60-70% removal at first hand at very low cost, and then the leftover can actually be treated with high end filtration systems or like high energy systems. But we can get the desired output at lower cost when we use a coupling of these kind of system also at time. So yes, it depends on initial concentration, what is the level of the final concentration that we are looking for, and the budget, feasibility, climatic conditions also vary at time. Like you cannot use biological systems say everywhere, particularly in the cold climates. It's like if you try to set up a biological system, there is high probability that it will fail. The nature of compound, if like for antibiotics, again, there is a high susceptibility of the biological system to fail if we are using antibiotic, because of the nature of the compound, they are synthesized to act adversely on the living or like microbial systems. So all these needs to be looked upon, what we want to remove and how much we want to remove, and then only we can set up a probably suitable treatment scheme.
Thank you, Professor Tiwari. So Professor Srivastava, in the question, it was specifically mentioned chronocatalytic degradation. And as I know, Professor Srivastava work on this. So can you please give your opinion on this, which one is the best and where we can use that?
I agree with all three, Dr. Mukherjee, Professor Tiwari, and Professor Sinha, that not a single technology will work optimally for all kinds of compounds. So what we need is a mixture of technologies which are suitable depending on what are the characteristics of the compound and all. So that is one part which has been very which has been highlighted by others. What I want to add is another angle to it, that eventually we also have to look at reducing the release of these compounds into the environment. For example, take these painkillers and all. Nowadays, we are not able to bear only a small amount of pain. Whenever something happens, we just take a painkiller. Earlier, our threshold for bearing the pain was much higher than what it is right now, and that is because these painkillers are widely and easily available. So what I am pointing out here is that we may also require some change in perception of that we reduce our reliance on non-essential pharmaceutical compounds. At least essential compounds are required, no doubt about it, but can we make use of some natural products and reduce our reliance on these compounds when they are not essential, and we can go without them. So if that is the case, then eventually it may also result in a lower load on our treatment facilities and all. And if we are going to use a train of different treatment technologies which are suitable for different types of compounds and all, then I hope that will present a more holistic solution to this problem of these pharmaceutical compounds coming in the natural environment, rather than focusing on the downstream treatment technology alone.
So thank you, Professor Srivastava. So the next question is now on the microplastics. So there was one question and then subsequent suggestion, which you already talked about. Can we reduce microplastic? The same person has given the suggestion, instead of plastic, we should use natural leaves, paper, and recycle the plastic. So the question is, can we reduce microplastic?
Yes, of course, it is a common sense. We have to reduce the unscientific disposal of our plastic products, bring more science into it so that we should be eventually able to reduce this, their release in environment.
Okay. The next question is, can we use these microplastic as an absorber?
This has been studied by many groups where they are studying it just as a beneficial absorber, where they try to absorb various kind of pharmaceutical ingredients on plastic balls and things like that, and then so that the bioavailability and transport into the body is also increased. On the other hand, downside is that these microplastics also can absorb various heavy metals and other organic contaminants which are present in the environment. So yes, depending on the partitioning behavior and other thermodynamic properties, these microplastics can act as the absorber of a variety of pollutants and all.
So the next question is, can we find these microplastic in air and we can inhale?
Yes, I think I also showed some result where people have actually estimated the concentration of microplastics in air, which is at breathable height. So yes, it is present. And there are ways through which we can actually sample and collect the sample and estimate their concentration.
And the other question is, can we reduce the consumption of microplastics through our food and water?
Again, it is not a very simple thing to answer. The holistic thing is that we have to reduce our unscientific disposal of plastics, the primary and micro or secondary microplastics which are entering into the food chain and all. Then only we can reduce the consumption. We can't work about, we can't do anything about a food or a drink item that is already contaminated with these microplastics, but we can ensure that in future their contamination is reduced. Then only we can reduce the consumption of these.
So the last question is, will oxidation of microplastic result into the nano-sized plastic? If so, will there be a surface charge on these plastic due to the deposition of other contaminants or species on these water and wastewater?
Yes, so this is also coming out to be a major concern when microplastics are there. If you are going for all these different treatment technologies, these larger micro-sized particles will also undergo some kind of fragmentation, and then they will result in nano-sized plastic particles. And unfortunately, we are not in a position to, with confidence, estimate these nano-sized plastic particles. And they are much more prone for entering the various blood streams, the tissues and all in human body, and even the this placenta barrier. And people have also reported that once you have these nano-sized plastic particles, they can also enter the brain. So which these larger micro-sized plastic particles will not be able to do. So if the plastic size is less than 120 nanometer or so, they can even cross this placenta barrier, even enter into the bloodstream, and then with that reach out to various other parts in the human and other organisms' body. So there will be a surface charge. It will also depend on what kind of process is happening and all, so what kind of environmental conditions are prevalent, what kind of pH redox conditions are present within the body and those things. So that will actually determine the surface charge on these nano or micro-sized plastic particles. And then, of course, that will also govern the deposition or absorption of other contaminants on them. So this is, again, not a very simple answer, not a straightforward. It depends on what kind of prevalent environmental conditions persist where these micro and nano-sized particles are present.
So another question is come from Ayush Tripathi. It's saying like, is it right perception that vegetarian food eaters are less likely to eat microplastic than non-vegetarian one?
I can't comment on that since data set that is available is very less. And for a vegetarian food, I don't think sufficient studies are available. So unless we are able to compare the amount of microplastics present in both these different varieties of food items, it will be unfair of me to comment on this.
Thank you, Professor Srivastava. So I think we are over with the questions from the attendees. So, and also we overshoot the allotted time. So I just want, I request all the attendees. So just give the a closing statement for 2 minutes each from like, what is the take home message for this topic, monitoring and degradation challenges for environmental contaminant. So I would like to invite first Professor Mukherjee for this.
So the take-home message is that, you know, we can reduce consumption, but even after that, it cannot be totally stopped. I mean, discharge of pharmaceuticals in water is, wastewater is going to happen. We can try to improve our treatment processes to handle that better. And, but monitoring is a must. Because as I said now, we still have very little monitoring based on work in India. So to, and to help in that, we can come up with more novel processes for monitoring also, apart from relying only on the gold standard processes as we discussed. So, and the, this problem is not going to go away. So we need to try to manage the problem better through the techniques that have already been emphasized throughout in the panel. So that's my take home message.
Thank you, Professor Mukherjee. Professor Sinha. Professor Sinha, you need to unmute.
Sorry. I also agree with Professor Mukherjee that monitoring is very, very essential and there should be certain regulations also. For example, we have now come up with the standards of pesticides. So we have to also come with the standards of other thing also, other microcontaminants also, so that it can be beneficial for the people who are drinking that water, and then it can be regulated also accordingly. So according to my, thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sinha. Professor Tiwari.
Yeah, I think most of the thing has already been said, but what I would just like to add is it's not just limited to pharmaceuticals or pesticides or any other thing, because we are discussing emerging contaminants here in general, and there are, I think, more than 80,000 chemicals are registered for uses, and somehow or other they are like after use, they are disposed in the environment, and then they eventually find their ways into the soil, water, or like our natural environment mediums. So of course there is a need for monitoring, there is a need for coming up with the technologies to control, which again can only be done if we realize the scale of problem, again emphasizing the need of the precise monitoring, okay, to the level and the health effects. So most of the times, like when we test water for pathogens or other things, like even the using water, we often do not test it for the toxicity, okay? Because if we are monitoring individual toxicity of one compound or other compound, we never know, but an overall toxicity assessment must be mandatory at least for domestic supplies, which I think is not being looked upon as of now. Okay, so that is another thing very important. And of course, as Professor Srivastava earlier also mentioned that, in fact, Professor Mukherjee said that it cannot be eliminated. That's very correct. It cannot be eliminated, but at least the reduction to some extent is possible in the uses of these compounds, and more so ever like unnecessary disposal, like the medicines, like we buy suppose 20 tablets and then use 4 and rest goes to the dustbin. So it can be like returned to the some hospital or that sort of thing. So the minimization is possible.
Thank you, Professor Tiwari. Professor Srivastava.
So I will just add to what Professor Sinha, Professor Mukherjee and Professor Tiwari have mentioned about the need for monitoring and all. So despite all our efforts, all these monitoring estimation for these emerging contaminants, whether it is microplastic or pharma compounds or pesticides, they are still very non-trivial and costly. So that actually limits the research on these emerging contaminants. And there is a need for developing more easy monitoring or detection of methods, for example, biosensors, as Professor Mukherjee already mentioned, some other kind of cheaply and easily available sensing technologies, which are also reliable. So that, in my opinion, if we are able to develop these, then it will also help the policymakers, the general public, and other people, and more understanding will come on these emerging contaminants.
So thank you, Professor Srivastava. So as like I just want to summarize everything. So as it started with the title, it says like monitoring and degradation challenges. It's you can see like the majority, the problem is still we are facing with the monitoring. Professor Mukherjee and Professor Srivastava, they have talked about how difficult to go for the, even for the monitoring, and how sophisticated analytical facilities we required for some of these emerging contaminants. So we can say we have to long go, we have to cover a long distance even just for the monitoring. And then by that, we can proceed and decide a different kind of degradation techniques, what Professor Sinha and Professor Tiwari talked about. And also there are many different challenges, whether if you are using an electrochemical process, it's generating some chlorinated byproducts, it can be more harmful, or the biodegradation where we have to see like how our species or the multicultural species are able to survive in treatment condition. And also like there are different aspects, for example, like there was some question related to the membranes. So still in the membrane technology, now the people are, even we are also working in coming with a new generation of electrocatalytic membrane. One of my PhD students is Najmul is working in that, where we want to come up with a certain kind of new generation membrane where degradation and separation can happen at the same time. So with this, I would really like to thank the panelists, Professor Mukherjee, Professor Sinha, Professor Tiwari, and Professor Srivastava from the International Society of Energy, Environmental, and Sustainability to agree and give their valuable talk and also the suggestion for this emerging contaminants monitoring and degradation challenges. And with this, I hand over to the to ISEES organizers. And probably I think the next session will start from 3 p.m. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, Professor Mukherjee, Professor Sinha, Professor Tiwari, and Professor Srivastava. And thank you, all the attendees.
Thank you. Thank you for conducting the session.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I would like to add one thing. Actually, next session is at 3 p.m., but our inaugural session is at 1 p.m.
So okay.
Dr. V.K. Saraswat, member Niti Aayog, is going to inaugurate our conference at 1 p.m. So inaugural session is 1 to 2 p.m.
So
all of you can join that inaugural session.
Thank you, Akhilin. So I would like to add I missed that. So our inaugural session is going to happen at 1 p.m. and I request all the attendees and panelists to join the session if possible. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And we will stop this session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Satantra.
Thank you.
Thank you.